بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، dear respected brothers sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. dear colleagues, good evening. Yes, good evening. I wish if I can speak in Dutch, but unfortunately I can't speak in Dutch. Maybe in the future, the more you welcome me here, the more I will be able to interact with the Dutch people, and then I'll be able, inshallah, to speak in Dutch in a matter of short while. We have a limited time, and we need to tackle a very important topic, which is Salafism or Islam. And I do apologize to the camera person, because I'll make his life difficult, because I like to keep moving. Yeah. I wanted to speak in the beginning about my experience, my first experience with the Dutch people. That goes back to 1996, and it was a very, very positive experience, actually. And I have to say that it was my first visit to the West, and it forms, in fact, it changed my views about the West. At that time, it was my first visit to the West, and I did not have that much experience about Western people, except those Western people who come to work in Saudi Arabia. And I was working with some Westerners there. But when I came to the West in 1996, in the first time, that was, maybe you can say that it was a cultural shock for me. And it amazes me how the West has changed after 9/11. The shift was so far, the shift was so big, and that needs a deep analysis why this has happened. Anyway, this is another subject that maybe we need to tackle sometime later, but let me just tackle the main topic that was given to me today. And inshallah, I have a very limited time, and I'll try to tackle it in the time that is given to me. As you know, that unfortunately Salafism has been receiving a lot of criticism in the media, or by the media, basically in the Netherlands. We are not experiencing something like this in Britain. Maybe the brothers or the people in German, they are experiencing something like this in Germany. But I think what people are experiencing here in the Netherlands, it might be unique. For me, at least, I haven't seen it in somewhere else in Europe. Why? This needs to be questioned. This needs to be analyzed. And inshallah, hopefully, throughout the discussion in this conference, maybe an answer can be identified. Now, what is Salafism? See, there are so many definitions of Salafism. And in fact, the biggest problem of the media and some politicians, when they, not the media, all of them, but some media outlets and some politicians, when they speak negatively or even positively about Salafism, is they fail to give a definition of Salafism. And I challenge them to give a proper definition of Salafism, because they can't. And those who are qualified to give a definition about Salafism, the academics, for example, they themselves fail to give a definition about Salafism. Does Salafism mean that you don't follow a particular school of thought? Does that mean this? Yeah. Does Salafism mean you believe in jihad? Does Salafism mean that you believe that Islam is the best way of life? What does it mean, really? Does Salafism mean you have a pure outlook for Islam, and you want everyone to have this pure outlook for Islam? Does it mean like this? Most of the people believe that Salafism is kind of that outlook, that look at Islam, that Islam is the pure religion and it should remain pure, and we should purify Islam from any kind of innovations or any kind of addition. And I think if you look at it from an abstract point of view, this definition is a beautiful definition. Yes? Because obviously, if we try to purify Islam from any kind of innovation, from any kind of addition, then we will go back to Islam that is actually mercy to the entire mankind. And the Prophet ﷺ was sent as a mercy for not only mankind, but for all living beings. And Allah confirmed this in the Quran. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have sent you as a mercy for alameen. Alameen includes ins, jinn, includes human beings, and includes even non-human beings. Islam is a mercy for even for the environment as well. Islam is mercy for Muslims and for non-Muslims. Islam is mercy for all human beings in this life, and most importantly, in the life after death. Now, so the point is, what is the definition of Salafism? When they want to ban Salafism, or when they want to ban Salafi organizations or Salafi mosques or something like this, what is the definition of Salafism? And once you go back to any definition of Salafism that is acceptable by even the scholars, the so-called scholars of Salafism, such as Ibn Taymiyyah, for example, or even to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, or even to the scholars before them, Imam Ahmad, or even to Imam Abu Hanifa, or Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi'i, you will see that Salafism is nothing but Islam. You will see that Salafism is nothing but Islam. What is Salafism? Is to take your rules from and your guidelines from what? From Quran and Sunnah. Does any Muslim reject Quran and Sunnah? In fact, if there is any Muslim who rejects Quran and Sunnah, he is not anymore Muslim. Agree or not? Yeah? Can a Muslim say, I believe in Islam, but I don't believe in Quran? Or I believe in Islam, but I don't believe in Sunnah? Yeah, we say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. All of us go back to Quran and Sunnah. All Muslims all over the world go back to Quran and Sunnah. Now, some academics might say, well, the issue is the interpretation of Quran and Sunnah. Yeah? So at least we say to those who say that the problem is the interpretation of the Quran and Sunnah, we say to them, at least let us agree that all Muslims believe in Quran and Sunnah and submit to Quran and Sunnah, and they take the Quran and Sunnah as their guidelines. Yeah? Now let us talk about the second issue, which is the interpretation of Quran and Sunnah. The interpretation of Quran and Sunnah. All Muslims in the world belong to, at least the Sunni Muslims, to one of the four schools of thought. Yeah? Either Hanafis, or Malikis, or Shafi'is, or Hanbalis. Even, they say, for example, Ibn Taymiyyah, he doesn't follow a madhab. He sometimes takes from Imam Abu Hanifa, sometimes he takes from Imam Ahmad, sometimes he takes from Imam Malik, and so on. Sometimes he would take opinions that are not endorsed by the official school of thought of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, for example. He might take the second opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa. He might take a third another opinion of not the official opinion of Imam Ahmad, and so on. At the end of the day, he is moving or maneuvering within the four schools of thoughts. Any Muslim in the world will be referring to those schools of thoughts. Maybe you might find one scholar here or there, he might have certain opinions in single masail, in single issues that go outside the four schools of thoughts. Maybe in the issue of talaq, yeah, one opinion. Maybe in the issue of idda, another opinion. Maybe regarding the issue of najasat. Something like this, minor issues. But in major issues, they don't go beyond the four schools of thoughts. Yeah? and this is well known throughout history. Ask any academic and they will confirm this. So Salafism in reality, my dear brothers and sisters, is going back to Quran and Sunnah in a very simple form and go back to the four schools of thoughts. In reality, Salafism is nothing but Islam. In reality, Salafism is nothing but Islam. Now, within Muslims, yes, we have certain maybe you can say sects or certain groups. We say that anyone can claim that he is Muslim, anyone. But we have a claim and we have a reality. Anyone who believes in Quran and Sunnah, so he is Muslim. Anyone who rejects Quran and Sunnah, he is not Muslim. So we say if someone, he says that he's a Muslim, but he doesn't want to accept Quran and Sunnah, he doesn't want to accept Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the final messenger, we will say to him with all due respect, okay, this is not Islam. In order to be a Muslim, you need to submit to Quran and Sunnah, full stop. If he says, yes, I want to refer to Quran and Sunnah, but I want to produce my own interpretation of Quran and Sunnah, we say to him that you are saying that the vast majority of Muslims are wrong, they misunderstood Islam, and you are the only one who understood Quran and Sunnah, and obviously this goes against common sense. Islam has been there for 1400 years. Yeah, Islam has been practiced for the past 1400 years. Islam has been practiced by superpowers. Yeah, the Khilafah Rashida was a superpower. After that, the Umayyad period was a superpower. The Umayyad period, if you know those who know history, it ruled maybe an area that is bigger than the Middle East, America, and Russia. If you want to calculate the area that Umayyad period ruled for almost 100 years, yeah, you want to calculate that area, it was bigger than the Middle East, plus America and Russia. That vast, okay? And it ruled that area according to Islam, according to Quran and Sunnah. Then after the Umayyad period, we have the Abbasi period, continued for almost 500 years. It was following the same pattern, yeah? And it was a huge civilization. And it continues for 500 years. And at one point, it was the main civilization in the entire world. Yeah? Then the Abbasi period or the Abbasi caliphate, yeah, the word caliphate is a bit sensitive. Yeah? The Abbasi caliphate fell down in 656, which is after almost 650 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which means that for 600 years it ruled this big area with Quran and Sunnah, referring to one of the four madhahib. Yeah, in fact, four madhahib were practiced throughout this big, huge civilization. Then the Abbasi Caliphate came to an end, as we know, and then after that, the Ottoman Caliphate started. And again, it ruled a huge area. At one point, it was the main civilization in the entire world for almost 200 years. And then after that, for the rest of 400 years, it was one of the main civilizations in the entire world. And there are those who know about history, there are statements from Western academics that confirm that Western non-Muslims in general used to have good relationship with the Ottomans. They used to send their children to study in some Ottoman universities. They used to seek help from the Ottomans. In fact, and historians confirm this, that once the Jews and some Christians were persecuted in Spain, they fled to who? To the Ottoman Empire. We Muslims provided Jewish people and some Christians shelter when they were persecuted by some Christians. And who provided them with this? the Ottoman Caliphate, the Islamic state of the Ottomans. Yeah? The media is always presenting a negative image of what? Of the Islamic State. Yeah? The word Islamic State is very frightening. It means killing, chopping the hands, etc., etc., or chopping the heads, etc., etc. Read the history and see what the Ottoman Empire provided for the entire civilization. Okay? So, and then the Ottoman Empire ended in 1924, as we all know. So, throughout history and throughout these huge civilizations, Muslims were practicing what? Muslims were referring to Quran and Sunnah and to one of those four schools of thoughts. Maybe some scholars were maybe moving from one school of thought to another school of thought, or sometimes they are adopting by the notion of ijtihad an opinion that maybe was not one of the official four schools of thoughts, and so on. But in general, they were referring to Quran and Sunnah and those four schools of thoughts. Now, we as Muslims, when we say that, well, this is our constitution, the Islamic constitution, Quran and Sunnah, and the interpretation is simple. We have the four school of thoughts. We are accused of being the barbaric Salafists, or we are being accused of the terrorist Salafist, or we are being accused of the extremist Salafist who are maybe now, they are just extremists and non-violent extremists, but after some time, by the conveyor belt theory, they will become what? They will become the terrorists. Subhanallah. We've been living in, we have built those civilizations that at once provided, or in fact, at many times provided shelter and help for Jewish people, Christian people, and then we are accused of being extremists. Who is going to turn to be terrorists? This is an oversimplistic view of Islam and what Islam can provide for humanity. Obviously, the notion of jihad will come. Obviously, any nation that sees itself as a great nation, it will not be accepted. It will not accept at any cost to be demonized. It will not accept at any cost to be slaughtered and just wait. It doesn't accept, or it will never accept to wait until it is slaughtered. It will never accept to be undermined. Obviously, they will defend themselves. Whether they defend themselves under the notion of jihad or whether they defend themselves under any notion, it is a natural human being reaction that once you are attacked, to be what? To defend yourself, to defend your honor. This is something well known, and all human beings will do that. It is a natural reaction, as we have said. Okay, so my dear brothers and sisters, this is Salafism. This is Salafism. And this means that every single Muslim in reality, he is a Salafi as far as he believes, as we said, in Quran and Sunnah, and goes back to the four madahib as a matter of interpretation for Quran and Sunnah, as simple as this. That's why I always challenge politicians, journalists, by providing me with a pure, robust definition of Salafism, and they end. They fail to provide such definition. As simple as this. Okay. Now, does that mean that the media is attacking Islam? If we say that Salafism is nothing but Islam, does it mean that the media is attacking Islam or some politicians are attacking Islam? Whether they say yes or no, in reality, they are attacking Islam. Yeah? Not all media outlets, but some politicians and some media outlets, they are attacking Islam. And what they are doing, and we have to be aware of this tactic, unfortunately, the tactic that is used by some Islamophobic and right-wing, whether media or politicians, is they want to divide us. Yeah? Yeah, I'm not attacking Islam. I'm attacking who? Salafists. You are not a Salafi. Yeah? But their definition of Salafism is not like what many people perceive Salafism is. Are you following this? Yeah? We as Muslims might have a detailed definition of Salafism. Yeah? But the media is not attacking that. The media is attacking anyone who wants to, anyone who believes in Quran and Sunnah and refer to those four schools of thoughts. As simple as this. Anyone who believes that Quran and Sunnah are the sacred words of Allah and His Messenger, if anyone who believes in the infallibility of Quran and Sunnah, anyone who believes that the Quran is a mercy to the entire mankind, إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم. Indeed, this book guides to that what is better. Anyone who believes in this ayah, that Quran and Sunnah guides humanity to the best practice, then he is Salafi, and he should be banned, and he should be controlled. This is how it is. This is what the media is presenting it. This is the reality of what is the media attacking, although they are not presenting it like this. They are presenting it as if they are attacking just part of the community, not everyone. They are not attacking Islam. They welcome Islam. They are happy with Islam. Then we need to ask them a question, which is, okay, forget about the definition of Salafism. Give us the definition of Islam. What does Islam mean? Unless you, as a non-Muslim, you want to define for me what Islam is. You need to tell me how to pray. You need to tell me how to make wudu. You need to tell me how to get married. And you need to tell me about these things, and I have to adopt them because this is Islam. If that is the case, make it clear that the Islam is defined by some politicians, some media outlets. And obviously, this is not acceptable. Obviously, this is not acceptable. We have the definition of Islam that has been, as I said, practiced by hundreds, by millions of people throughout hundreds of years. Okay, what is the danger of attacking Islam? Although they don't say that they are attacking Islam, they are attacking Salafism. What is the danger of that? This is very, very dangerous, my dear brothers and sisters. This is very, very dangerous. Because at the end of the day, in any society, there should be homogeneous and peaceful coexistence between the components of the society. Yeah, even if they have a huge ideological differences, they should have what? Peaceful coexistence. Yeah, and we Muslims should be, and we are open about that, we should be more keen to have peaceful coexistence between the components of the society as whole. That's why we are vocal against anyone who carry any crime, whether a mass crime, that is called terrorism, or a single crime. We are against that because we are in favor of peaceful coexistence between all components of the society, irrespective of or despite our major ideological differences, despite the differences in our culture, in our cultures, despite our differences as human beings, because as human beings, don't expect us, yes, as human beings, to live with the same set of values. So why are we forced to accept values that are alien to our nature as Muslims? You Muslims, you have to do this, otherwise you are not European. You Muslims have to do this, otherwise you are extremist. You Muslims have to accept that, otherwise you are not welcome in this country. And to conclude, my dear brothers and sisters, what is the future? Yeah? What is the future? We have to say that now, see, European countries, Europe in general, in fact, the whole world, and in particular Europe, is in a dynamic state. So the definition of Europe is in a continuous change. Europe, maybe 50 years ago, was a white continent, was a Christian continent. But now, you can't say that Europe is a white continent. You can't say that Europe is a Christian continent. Can you say that? No one says that anymore. So what is Europe? Europe is a continent for Christians, Muslims, Jews, no faith. It is for all of us. So Europe has to adopt a new definition that is what? That is also dynamic, that suits those demographic changes that are taking place in Europe. You can't force yourself upon me. You want me as a Muslim not to force myself upon you. Yes, I agree. I am not forcing myself upon you. But why are you forcing yourself on me? This is the question. You have, as a Muslim, you have to assimilate. And when I say, why don't you accept Islam optionally? Oh, no, you see, you as Muslims are forcing yourself upon Europe. You want to take over. You want to change Europe. You want to do this and that and this and that. You are being extremist, and then you will end up by being terrorist. But it is allowed for you to say, you Muslim has to accept this, has to do that, has to abandon this, has to give up your religion, has to do this, otherwise you are extremist. No, no. This continent, this country, for example, which is Holland, is owned by all of us. We are partners in this continent, in this country. I don't force myself on you. Yes, I debate my views. Yeah, I'm vocal about my views. Be vocal about your views. We are all partners. I have to deal with you as a partner, and you have to deal with me as what? As a partner. Yes, I am a minority. Maybe now, later I might be a majority. You have to respect me, and I have to respect you. It is a mutual respect, mutual peaceful coexistence. You don't ask me, you don't treat me. The governments, the European governments, should not treat Muslims as visitors. They have to comply with what? With certain rules that are defined by certain people. No. We are European Muslims. We are partners in Europe. As we said, I am not a visitor. I am a citizen here. You are European citizens. My dear brothers and sisters, don't accept to be treated as a visitor who should just comply to the norms that are forced upon him by the host. Netherlands is not a host for us. It is our country. It is your country as Dutch people. Britain is my country. I'm not going to Britain as a visitor, and they should not expect from me to live there as a visitor and to assimilate. Why? Both of us as Britain, and the values of Britain has to take into consideration that we are partners in living in Britain. We all define the values of Britain. We all define the values of Europe. The definition of Europe has to be dynamic enough and has to accommodate the new demographic changes. If we don't do this, then there will be a serious problem, not only for Muslims, but for the entire continent. Because obviously, human beings by nature, they can't accept to be forced to abandon their values. Human beings by nature, they don't accept to be criminalized because of their values that they have been practiced for hundreds of years. This is the way forward as I see it, and it should be seen like this, wallahu a'lam, that we need to assert our identity as Muslims, European Muslims. It doesn't mean that if you are a Muslim, if you are a European, you should abandon your religion. No, 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 no. We are European Muslims. What does that mean? It doesn't mean that we have to abandon our values, our cultures, in order to fit in Europe. No, Europe has to fit and Europe has to accommodate all of us because it is our continent. European countries are our countries, as simple as this. This is the way forward, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khaira, barakallahu fikum, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.